Sir, are you okay?
I just got this pain. It just hurts in my chest, and I just don't feel well at all.
Has it been going on a long time?
It's almost been about an hour and a half now, almost okay. 2 hours.
Do you have heart problems normally?
Well, the doctor says I had a little bit of something, but I think I'm okay. I've been fine.
Okay. Can you describe what it feels like right now?
It almost feels like someone's grabbing me and just squeezing.
Okay, all right. Hey, do you have any allergies to any medications at all?
Not that I know of, no.
Have you taken an aspirin yet?
No aspirin.
I'll tell you what, why don't I just get one of these adult aspirins? Have you had any bleeding in your have you had any gastrointestinal bleeding or?
No, I don't have any history of that or anything. I've never had that problem.
You can just go ahead and chew that up.
Okay.
And then now this is the first time this has happened, no real history, huh?
No, it just came on me all of a sudden.
Okay. Have you called the ambulance yet?
No, okay. I don't want an ambulance.
I'm gonna go ahead and call the ambulance.
I'll be fine, I think I'm gonna sit up a minute.
I understand, but this looks an awful lot like something that could be a heart attack, and I think it'd be wise if we make sure we get you checked out. If it's nothing, mm-hmm. we don't have to worry about it. But if it all was right. a heart attack, time is really important. Is that okay if I call?
It's all right.
Okay. Go ahead. You just relax there.
I'm trying.
Are you comfortable the way you're sitting?
Sort of. Oh, this hurts.
Yeah, 911. I think we have a gentleman who's having a heart attack. Now let's talk about cardiovascular disease and heart attacks. When we talk about cardiovascular disease, I think it's important that we realize that there are controllable risk factors and uncontrollable risk factors. Some of the controllable risk factors has to deal with diet, exercise, stress, smoking, blood pressure, and diabetes. Blood pressure and diabetes, especially if you could control it through exercise, diet, and medication, but refuse to do so. The uncontrollable aspects of cardiovascular disease would be gender. Males have a higher risk factor than females, genetically. That's being changed a bit because of stress. Women are in the workplace as much or more than males, and so those are starting to make up for what women naturally had going for them in the genetic aspect. We know that age is an uncontrollable factor. As we get older, we have these other debilitating problems like arthritis, back injuries, knee injuries. If we didn't prepare ourselves through a nice, active, younger area of our lives, we're going to pay for it as we're older because we won't be able to maintain a healthful lifestyle, and that's only going to complicate cardiovascular disease. Race. We know from statistics that Hispanics and Black people are more prone to cardiovascular disease. There's some different things behind that we could philosophize about, which would be, is it a diet? Is it traditions? Is it part of the aspect of our culture? Are we eating, fried foods versus non-fried foods? Is it that we eat fattier foods than others? And so on and so forth. But we do know, just based on statistics, that the race piece of this does have some aspects that tilts the scale towards cardiovascular disease, and we need to be aware of that. Let's just say that those predisposing factors have caught up and the person actually develops the symptoms of a heart attack. Well, what are those symptoms? The classic symptoms of a heart attack for a male is profuse sweating, pressure in the chest, difficulty breathing, dizziness, weakness, pain under the breastbone, sternum, up into the neck or radiating down the left arm or right arm, nausea, vomiting, this impending doom feeling. I think I'm gonna die. I mean, it's such a terrible thing to suffer through. These individuals usually cannot ignore it for long, not when it gets that bad. I said that males have these signs and symptoms. Females might be a little bit different. In my background and history as a paramedic on the street, what I noticed about females is that the pain is a little bit less classic. It can be more of a back pain. They tend to think that it's muscular in nature. It does not seem to be as crushing. We know that females do not usually sweat as profusely as males anyways. And because of that, they don't have this pouring sweat response. They tend to think that it's indigestion or just tightness. They can tend to put it off a lot longer and cause more heart damage from that. And therefore, you know, when I've responded to the heart attack patients that were females, many times they were already in congestive heart failure, and the reason we got the call was difficulty breathing because they had heart failure. You're going to want to bring the person into a position of comfort, whatever they feel most comfortable in. Maybe it's sitting down. Maybe it's leaning up against a wall. Maybe it's standing up. Whatever makes them feel comfortable, that's the position we want them to be in. We can loosen up tight clothing if it's around the neck. If they have a tie on, you can loosen the tie. If it's tucked in or their belt is tight, you can loosen that up as well. Whatever makes them feel more comfortable and less anxious. A lot of what you say to the person can bring down the anxiety factor. Remember, with anxiety, we build fight or flight mechanisms, and that response can increase heart rate, it can increase blood pressure, it can cause vasoconstriction, and all of those things we don't need. We want the person to relax. So telling them that they're in good hands, that help is on the way, that we're going to take good care of them, that we're not going to leave them, and that we're going to be by their side helping them through this helps to reduce that anxiety. Beyond that, for the 2010 guidelines, we now will encourage the person, if they do not have an allergy to aspirin or do not have a history of gastrointestinal bleeding, we can actually encourage them to take one adult dose aspirin or two baby aspirins. As long as they're not coated, they can chew them up and swallow them. This aspirin helps to make the platelets slipperier so that they'll pass by each other and not continue to get stuck and create a bigger clot. It's not like Coumadin or a blood thinner per se, but aspirin has been known scientifically to help prevent the further buildup of blood clots and will help to protect the person. If this person has had a history of angina and they have nitroglycerin tabs or spray, we can assist them by getting it for them so they don't have to stress themselves out and go get the medication. Excuse me, but bring it to them and help them by taking it out of the bottle and giving it to them. These things will be assistive to them while we wait for the ambulance to arrive. Monitor this patient, because if this person goes unconscious or unresponsive and stops breathing, we're going to begin CPR immediately. If we have access to an AED, we're going to bare the chest, dry it off, and follow the guidelines for AED usage. And time is of the essence to treat this person. But getting the ambulance on the way, getting emergency medical services on the way, and getting this person to final treatment so that we can resolve the problem is key. So don't delay your treatment, and don't delay calling emergency medical services.